Hey, it's me, Destin. This is the second channel for Smarter Every Day here. What you're gonna see is bonus content. This is stuff that I thought was fascinating, but I couldn't put it in the main channel video because maybe it's too technical for a general audience, or maybe it's just too long. So I decided to put it here. This video is all about how Kodak in Rochester, New York controls the quality of the film they're manufacturing as they're manufacturing. This is Ektar 100. This is actually what they were running the day I was there. The first thing we're gonna see is a scanner that's in line. Remember the whole 3D model of the whole plant? Well, this scanner is located at this location right here. This is something that's happening in line. They create this raster image of any dirt or imperfections in the film. We're gonna get to see this, and then we'll come back and I'll tell you what else we're gonna look at.
Here's where there's a scanner in here. Again, sorry, it's kind of loud in here.
Okay.
And again here, in order to get it by the scanner without any roller contact, we have to have reversers every now and then, you know, to float the air so it floats over these also. But we have more turning bars. But this is our scanner.
So, is this infrared?
Yeah, we have an infrared scanner and a helium neon one that's kind of a reddish light.
A laser.
Yeah, laser. So we have two different lasers they can select to use. And it's going through a bunch of mirrors coming out. There's a big mirror, carousel mirror that's spinning.
So it's going to raster scan a beam across the well.
One more time, please.
It's going to raster scan as that spins the infrared beam across the well. And it's looking for transmission or reflection. If there's a piece of dirt or anything on it, it will be detected as a difference.
So when it comes to film, we've got dust, the scanner's gonna catch that, right? But there's this other thing, there's actual chemistry that we have to worry about, and that's what we're about to see. They actually develop the film, they'll take little sections out and develop it, and then they'll make sure that it meets certain quality standards. So we're gonna go to the lab now where they do what they call sensitometry, and they check all the film and make sure it's good enough to sell. Because if you think about it, if they're gonna sell you a little cartridge, a little 35 millimeter cartridge of film, you have to know as a photographer it's gonna be good, because you're gonna shoot somebody's wedding with this. You might get the kiss at a wedding, and you have to make sure it's right. So this lab we're about to see is exactly how they do that. This is where they check and control the quality of Kodak film before it goes out the door.
Behind that wall are where the film comes in from when we were coding upstairs and you were doing the roll transfer, on the back side, on the dark side of that garage door, was coated film. Once that's done, people will take samples and send it to the other side of this wall. Now, we're not gonna go there because it's dark and they're testing, but I'll show you, it's just another rolly door.
So a lot of this hardware and test equipment was made back in the day.
Yep.
If it breaks, what do you do?
Well, we have very good engineers. There's always eBay, and we're upgrading. So okay. I'll show you upgrades as well. So through the rolly door, all kinds of testing. They're gonna cut it into 35 millimeter strips. It's gonna be large areas where we're looking for general physical quality.
Mm-hmm.
And then the film strips are loaded into the front end of the photo processing. And this is the back end.
Got it.
So, C41, ECN, black and white, industrial, ektachrome, they're all here.
Oh, wow.
So some of them are dedicated, some of them are shared. So, these are mini labs. So that would have been what would have been at a local CVS at the time.
Oh, these are mini labs.
Yeah.
Okay. Can I step up here?
Yep.
So, that's amazing. And so these are all the processing fluids.
So the various tanks.
Let me adjust the sensitivity. So you've got all the different chemicals and stuff like that. Stop bath. Okay, so we learned about this at Indy Film Lab down in Alabama.
Yeah, that was a fun one.
Did you watch the video?
Yes, I did.
What'd you think?
It was well done.
Thank you.
Yeah.
We had fun.
They're a good group.
They're really cool at Indy.
Yeah.
Yeah. So where do you get your film developed when you shoot?
Row Photo is around here. They're a professional photographer. And sometimes I'll just throw it in,
Yeah.
I'll send it in and kind of test it. Once in a while, it's just to say, how's the world doing? And
So you're kind of testing the system.
As a back room kind of thing, not officially.
Yeah, you just want to know.
You know, when our customers, again, we're a film manufacturer. We sell directly for certain films, but we have customers like Kodak Alaris. They'll sell our professional and our consumer films. So if we hear back from them that there's some issue in the trade, we get involved.
So E6 development is slide film. So like the photo will actually look like the colors of the photo.
It's a direct positive.
Direct positive. So it's not a photo negative, it's a photo positive. And my understanding, Jeff, is you were instrumental in the development of...
It's not created. I led the team, and I was the emulsion designer to update three of the colors, three of the emulsion records that we didn't like quite the film performance.
Got it.
Jim Fitzgerald is the film designer.
Okay, so...
But we had a ball with it. It took us a long time.
Am I seeing a film coating...
This is a leader.
Okay.
There's not film there.
Got it.
We will be coating Ektachrome at the 1st of January. The next time we'll be coating some. But this whole room had to be added on.
Wow.
Yeah, it was an expensive, but very...
So this room, if I understand correctly, this is for testing Ektachrome. Okay, that's awesome.
Yep. Hey guys, can we bother you?
How's it going?
Hello, very good, good.
Morning, afternoon.
Good morning.
So how's it going, guys?
In this room, the operators, technicians are going to be examining the film on a light box, looking for any defects. The sensitometer, in the other room are the sensitometers where we expose the different levels of light through a step tablet, and then they're read over here. I mean, you can see on that screen there.
Is it okay if I walk over there? So is it a histogram?
Well, it's a densitometer. So take a look at this.
Uh-huh.
So there's your red, green, and blue exposure.
Got it. So there, do you have units here? It's a logarithmic trace.
It's log exposure.
Gotcha.
I don't know how many lux, different scales depending on different films.
This is the place where I get intimidated.
All right, we'll scare you some more.
Yeah, yeah. No, so is that a good trace?
Yeah.
Now, why is it good? How can you tell it's good? Because it's nice and parallel?
Well, and I don't see any red.
You don't see any?
Nobody's scrambling right now to fix something.
Okay.
All right. So,
got it.
So you know, but back at my desk, I would be looking at this as the data comes out.
Got it.
All right, but here they're examining quality. And there are like various defect cards, streaks. They're graded from A to G. And there are spots. And all of those, the operators are gonna line up and then assess the quality. And then we have to decide, is it usable or not usable? And it might be just one strip that we'll cut away.
Got it. You get as much as you can.
Yep.
Yeah, it's awesome.
All right.
How long have you been working here, man?
2.5 years now.
You like it?
Love it.
My name's Destin.
Hunter.
Hunter, nice to meet you, dude. So what are you doing? Are you in the quality lab here? You're testing stuff?
I'm part of the examiners group.
Yeah.
So as they're testing the film and processing it, we look at it, see if there's any sort of defects, basically just report it up to the control room if we see anything that's 5 degrees.
Yeah, that's awesome. So you're... If something gets through, you're like the net that tries to catch the bad stuff, and if something gets through, it's on you guys.
Yeah.
It's awesome. Nice to meet you, Hunter.
Nice to meet you as well.
Take it easy, man.
You too.
I like, what, can I ask you what's on your, is that a loop?
So, this is our 7 times.
Uh-huh.
So we have the 7 times as well as a 3 times.
Can you show me what looking at some film looks like? Do you have any?
A bunch. I'm trying to find something a bit more exciting than these computers.
This board's for narrow. So we have the 3 candy stripes.
Candy stripes?
That's what these 3 are called.
Okay.
It's to show the different layers of the film.
Uh-huh.
Then we have the heavy density and the light density, or the normal density, and then a clear section.
Okay.
So this has a heavier density, so more light gets exposed on this. Normal density, so the average amount, and no light gets onto this. So what we would do to examine it is we would take,
first are three times, and we would scan everything on it.
So what are you looking for? Can I see through your thing there? So what are you looking at?
Really anything that sort of pops out to us.
Can you find something and show me what it may look like?
All of this film so far has been clean, but there's a little speck here that would catch my eye at first. I'm not sure how well it would pick up. It's kind of small.
It's very tiny. There's a little bitty speck on there, and the camera doesn't like it at all. Okay, there it is. So something like that, what would you do? Would you throw out the whole lot, or?
Well, after we saw that, we look at it with our seven times, and I don't know if it was going to be able to pick it up.
Yeah, it's in there.
But looking at that, I can tell that that's just a piece of dirt or something that got on it while it was down here with us. So that's fine. But if that was something, say something got in it to the emulsion while they were coating and got under it, then we would call up for 5 degrees to the control room. Most of the time, they'll cut the entire slit out. Depending how bad it is, they might shut down and go through and try and clean the machine up, depending how, you know, if it's like a rust spot or something, it's getting scratched off of the coating machine or something like that.
Well, how do you communicate to the room, hey, this section of film, I mean, is it, do you do it in lots of, I can't see that because of how dark it is, but how do you communicate to the control room what section is, quote, bad?
We have the roll number. So each film is, so for this one, it starts at 11 start, 11 finish. In between them, each roll of film has a splice.
Uh-huh.
So it's sort of, we would say, you know, if that was a spec, we would measure it. So in this case, it'd be 12.7 or 12.5, my bad.
So remember when Brian was saying how important the AGVs were?
Yes.
So we know which one had which roll?
Yes.
So what they're going to do here is he's going to say, hey, there's a spot. And each film has its release specifications. A certain number of spots per square foot are allowed, or a certain amount of spots per 100 feet are allowed. But if it looks like something, as he said, was due to the handling here, it's not an issue. If it's suspect, iron is a big one. We don't like to have iron. That indicates usually rust somewhere. And if it's in a particular location and repeated, so from here it might come to my group and say, do you want to take more samples? Do we want to test this roll of film? Or are we going to look for that location? So that's 12 inches and 5/8, so 12.5, right? And we're going to look at other places on that to see if it's there. If it is, then we start looking at, does it repeat? Is there a roller that's got something on it that's constantly making a mark?
So for example, Hunter, if you see this spec, and you said it's where? Can you push this back up? So you said that spec is at 11 3/4, for example, and you resampled different sections of the film and you repeatedly saw something at 11 3/4, that would indicate that something in the mechanical processing is wrong in that space and they have to try to find it.
Yeah.
So that's a big deal.
Yeah.
Okay. So how long, you're thinking about this when you say, hey, I found a spec, there's all kinds of consequences for Hunter raising the red flag.
Yeah.
And those are good consequences because it makes the quality better. But you still have to think about that.
Absolutely. There is no consequences for him raising a red flag.
Okay.
There's action items after it.
That's the way to say that.
We want him to find it. Because if it gets out of our handles, if we finish it and package it and it gets to customers, that's horrible. That's what we don't want.
Oh, so this is the normal manufacturing tension between production and quality.
It's not tension at all.
It's just feedback.
Feedback. Absolutely.
Okay.
We want as much things identified because each film has been tested as to how much we can take. How many problems per square whatever area is okay and is normal. Again, size is important. You know, is it really big? Is it something that we are unused to seeing? Certain products are hypersensitive to certain elements, conditions.
Right.
But No, we want everybody to tell us exactly what's being seen because we're not looking at the whole film. We're looking at pieces and we're extrapolating to the whole film.
Well, Hunter, as a person who uses your products, thanks for keeping the quality good, man.
Oh, no problem.
It's pretty good. So which color behaves the best normally?
A lot of the times The magenta is usually the one that doesn't act up the most. Most of the time, they'll all be okay and look the way they're supposed to, as long as nothing's wrong with the melt or the coat or anything like that. It's only when something goes awry that they start looking a bit messed up, which is something that we look for. Most of the time, we don't actually inspect the color strip. It'll be like pushed down. We mostly use it for density. And if we see something in the normal density, we try and use the candy stripes to see which layer it is.
Oh, I see. So if I saw a streak here in the thick part, then, so can I move this?
Yeah.
So the candy stripe is covered. So you're looking at the whole film. You see a streak, then you would open it up and you'd say, oh, look, there's a streak on the yellow, but not on the magenta. So that's probably where the issue is.
Kind of. We would also use a color paddle. And so by looking at through the different color filters, it will highlight and show how...
Can you put it in there?
It'll highlight other things in it.
Uh-huh.
So you would use it by putting it up to your face and just sort of moving it.
Oh, it your nose is...
Yeah, it's got a little nose slot and everything.
Oh, wow. That's awesome.
So if it's in the cyan record and he gets to the red filter, it'll look black. So he'll see a dark black spot. And if it's in a different, or if it's in two color records, he'll see a black spot in two of the filters.
Can I look through this, please?
Yeah.
So I've got, let me get my things set up correctly. So I've got yellow, magenta, and cyan, correct, Jeff?
On the film.
On the film.
Yes.
So I'm going to look at first, I'm going to look at yellow. I'm going to look through the blue. Okay.
And it goes what?
Yellow goes black.
Yep.
Magenta looks blue. Okay. So now I'm going to go to the green. Yellow again goes black. No, yellow does not go black. This is confusing. Huh. Wow. I'm just going to have to take your word for it, Hunter.
So if you look through the green filter into the magenta film, that line should look black.
Oh, that was it. Okay, I see it.
And then if you look through the cyan film with the red filter, that will now look black.
So each color lets you test a different...
It allows you to then look at a spot that might have color and you trying to figure out which layer is it acting in.
That's fascinating. A lot of color theory here, huh?
Well, definitely.
Thank you, Hunter.
All right, so that's how Kodak makes sure that every roll of film you buy is high enough quality to put in your camera and shoot a picture of your dog or your wedding or whatever. I think that's really interesting. Last thing, I want to say thank you to the patrons of Smarter Every Day. You let me make videos about things that I enjoy, in this case, a super deep dive into Kodak film because it's amazing. So big thanks to you, the people that support on Patreon, patreon.com/smartereveryday. There was no sponsorship here by Kodak. This was completely Smarter Every Day funded by the patrons, and I'm excited about that. If you'd like to sign up, I would be grateful. Also, I'm going to send you a baseball. My goal with Patreon is to underpromise and overdeliver. So I don't do like, at this tier you get this, and this tier you get this. I just try to do right by you if you support on Patreon, and hopefully keep you happy. If you want to check that out, feel free to do that. I would be grateful. Anyway, there's another video here on Smarter Every Day 2 where we talk about how they make the silver halide, or halide, however you want to say it, at the plant and how they control all the chemicals. It's amazing. It's the chemistry of film. And also there's, of course, the main channel video if you want to see that. I am so grateful that you are on this Kodak film journey with me. It's encouraging to see that you enjoy it as much as I do. Anyway, I'm Destin. You're getting smarter every day. Have a good one. Bye.